Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
Cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
And we have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said, empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup. It becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now, water can flow, or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you wanna be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
All right. Hey, how's it going, everybody? Welcome to Comic Book Radio. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti, and this is episode 188. Tonight, my guest is Nandor Fox Schaefer. We're going to be talking about his book. He's got this book called The Fabled Offering. The link is in the description of the show, but I'm really looking forward to talking to him about sci-fi and fantasy adventure and all that good stuff. See why he's interested in that and how that all come about. Before we bring on Nandor, I want to talk to you guys here. We got Spicer McLeroy in the chat. What's up, Spicer? We had a good show yesterday, buddy. I'm glad to see you're doing well. Thank you for joining us in the chat tonight. Appreciate it. And yesterday, people were telling me that they got like 9 notifications or something for that show. I guess StreamYard was having trouble with pairing up with YouTube or whatever when it came to some of the live shows being put up yesterday. And maybe that was one of them. Maybe that's why some of you guys got all these multiple notifications for that show yesterday. Hopefully that didn't happen today. I can only imagine. But yeah, I got an email notification or something about that. So everything seems to be okay now. Fingers crossed again that today you guys didn't get 9 notifications about the show. Cole King, good to see you. Yeah, man, hope you're having a good night. We got JW Learning here too. What's up, JW? Hope you're doing good. All right. So without further ado, let's bring him on. The man of the hour, Mr. Nandor Fox Schaefer. What's up?
Hey, Pete. What's up, man? It's such a pleasure to be here and be a part of this series on the Comic Book Radio. I feel like, you know, very, very honored and privileged to be here. And especially episode 188. I mean, man, talk about a run you've had. That's awesome.
Yeah, we're getting up there, 12 away from 200. I can't believe it.
Yeah, you're almost there. Do you have anything special in mind for 200, or are you just gonna kind of go with the flow there?
No, it might actually even end up being just a guest, just a regular show.
Yeah. Well, hey, that works, you know. Whoever gets that lucky spot should be very privileged and happy.
Yeah, it's been crazy. I do these maybe 4 to 5 nights a week, some weeks maybe 6 nights a week. So they've been adding up, and it's been a blast. So I'm glad you're on here, episode 188. And there you go.
Yeah, but I know I'm sure a few people have, you know, talked about this, a few other guests, but, you know, I always enjoyed the 5-minute pitch streams that you would have.
Open mic shows.
The open mic shows, I was on there a few times, and I gotta say, that was just like such a great proving ground and a great way to like learn how to pitch and learn how to talk about your comic. And it's really helped me with like going to conventions and, you know, trying to grab people and talk with them and you know, see how fast you can kind of get their attention. So I just wanted to thank you for doing those, even, you know, I know good. It's been a while, but no, I really enjoy those. I got to you know, meet a lot of cool creators that way, you know, and you know, see like, whoa, there's a lot of people out there making comics and people that I hadn't seen before. And, you know, I'm sure there's some people who, you know, are a bit hesitant to go on an interview for an hour, hour and a half or two. And so like giving them that opportunity to do that, you know, you're able to find people you may have never seen before. So anyways, I just wanted to throw that out there. It was really cool. It's something that I miss.
Oh, thank you, man. I've been toying with the idea of bringing that back at least one day a month, you know? So I might do that. I might do that on Friday nights, because I'm doing a different show structure now, where on Fridays it'll be like an open lines type show. So either it'll be up to the chat on what they want to talk about, or a feedback forum type show. But I might do an open mic show too. And then Saturdays I want to have like a Supernatural type show, so like Supernatural super show on Saturday. And then Sundays are draw streams, but Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays I want it primarily to be a guest. If not, it'll be me talking about some kind of a comic related topic. But I might do that. I kind of miss it too, and I think maybe once a month that would be a good amount of time for people to, you know, I let them know about when the day will be, and then hopefully we get a bunch of people here and they can talk about their topic. Because you're right, because there are some people, especially when they're starting off, they're not really, you know, they're kind of like a deer in headlights, you know, when it comes to, oh man, I gotta talk about it for an hour. What am I gonna say? You know, and that's something too with this show, where I try to make it focus not just about an hour of here's your campaign or whatever it is. 90% of the whole show is going to be conversational. So if you're someone who's not acclimated to that just yet, it could be harrowing.
Definitely. I mean, you know, especially, you know, I'm all writer and artist types, you know, it's like we're happy in our own heads. And sometimes when we start to talk, it doesn't come out the way we expected it to. I think that'd be really cool. I hope I don't know, have other people kind of poked you about that, or is that something?
They have, and it's interesting to very similar comments to what you had said, where you know, they miss it. They saw a lot of great creators on there and helped them with their pitches as well. So, you know, for a while there I felt like, I don't know, is this helping anybody? And that's why I kind of ended up stopping. But I think if we can get back in a groove, you know, one day a month, that's 12 shows a year that are like that, instead of every single week. I think that could be special and still be helpful for people. So yeah, I think I'll do that. I think I'll bring that back.
Sweet.
You've convinced me, Nando.
I'll be there.
All right, man. Well, let's put the focus on you now. Let's enough kind of finagling trying to schedule out my show. I want to talk about what, not just what you're up to, but what's kind of brought you down this path. So let's start at the beginning. In terms of comics, especially, what was your first experience with comic books?
Man, my first experience with comic books, it was probably, you know, in terms of superheroes, it was definitely you know, animated shows and like TV and movies, like that really got me into searching for comics, you know, and looking for comics and learning about like, oh hey, like there's a whole history of these characters, you know. I grew up, I was born in 1997, so I grew up, you know, in the time of the early, you know, Marvel movies and like X-Men and Sam Raimi's Spider-Man. And, you know, I remember being like 5 or 6 years old and watching those and being like, whoa, like, you know, these are awesome. And, So I think the first time I went to a comic book store, my father took me when I was about probably 8 or 9 years old, maybe earlier, but that's kind of where I started to really go to a proper comic book shop. And I got to find out that, oh, there's like a specific store that's just all comics. You know, sometimes I would see comics in different stores in my area, but not just, you know, a brick and mortar LCS. And so really it was, you know, looking at that and begging my mom and dad, you know, to take me, you know, as frequently as possible, so I could get some comics. And, you know, a lot of the time I was going through the dollar bin, because, you know, that's what your mom and dad can afford, you know, sometimes. And that's okay, because you're just like, ooh, you know,
that's treasure hunting. That's,
yeah, where the good stuff, yeah, is.
That's still where I go.
Definitely. Definitely. Like I don't, you know, it's crazy, because I've found, you know, things that, you know, you find really obscure things that maybe no one's looking for anymore. And some of that stuff is the best, you know, it can be the best stuff that no one's looking for. And so, you know, my earliest comic book memories, like, you know, were comics that were either gifted to me or ones that I would rent from the library or, you know, just from the dollar bin at my comic book shop. And a lot of that was stuff that was, like, some of it was older stuff, but a lot of it was the newer stuff that was coming out around the time, like Ed Brubaker and Steve Epting's Captain America, or it may have been Matt Fraction's Iron Man, kind of in that like early 2000s, like right before the MCU was about to kick off. And so there was that kind of period of Marvel where like Hickman had just taken over the Fantastic Four. And, you know, it was like such a exciting time for me to like get in on all of these series that were happening, because it felt like a lot of you know, exciting artists and fresh ideas were kind of coming at that time, and things were kind of switching up, and it was really interesting kind of when I look back at it, you know. But you know, before that, it's like I would go to my Barnes & Noble and I would pick up the classic Stan Lee and Jack Kirby and Steve Ditko collections and graphic novels, because I was like, well, how did this all start? You know, like how did this all begin?
Yeah, yeah.
What was it, you know, like, we're here now, but like, how do I put the pieces together? Like, how did we get here? And so that really started to like make all the gears turn. And then a real big helpful book that was just like in books like these that I'm about to mention, really, you know, like I would pick up Marvel Encyclopedia, or I would pick up like character encyclopedias and things like that. And, you know, I would read those like page by page and just learn about the history of these universes, you know, Marvel or DC. And it, you know, I started to see like the big picture and the fuller picture of like, oh, so like DC had these crisis events and Marvel has had these events throughout history with the Avengers, and these are all the different lineups that have, you know, changed over the years. So that kind of really informed, you know, what I would look for, you know, and like, ooh, I want to read that story. Like, what is that story
about? That's
funny.
That's the trading cards from the early 90s did that for me.
Mm,
you know,
yeah.
Learning more about the characters and being a kid, you don't have a lot of money, and it helped you make a more informed buying decision, as weird as
yeah.
that sounds, you know.
It did. It really did. It was like, okay, I could purchase, you know, these few graphic novels or you know, maybe pricier books or whatever, or I could just get this character encyclopedia or this, like, you know, even they would come out with those, you know, kind of like character profile issues where, you know, you would find those and you could read about them and read about their abilities. And that's really, you know, what I was fascinated with, you know, was just it wasn't like the popularity of the character. It was just, who is this guy? Like, I love the design. Like, I love the costume. Like, it didn't really matter if they had their own series or, you know, if they had a movie. It was just, I really like, you know, the sound of this character's name. I like the ring of it. I like the color palette. I like, you know, maybe it was the specific picture or like the artist that they used in that character encyclopedia. And I was like, I want that comic. Like, where is that from? Like, who drew that? And so, you know, then that opened up like the artists and the creators and like who's making these things. And so, you know, after a while you start to pay attention to the credits and you start to pay attention to, you know, like, man, this comic was really good. Who made this? And, you know, that again became this huge, deal for me where, the comics was a shared thing with my brother and I, and we would play around with the idea of like, what if these creators were on this book and like, what would they do with it? And like, we would like come up with our own, like if we were running Marvel and DC, like which creators would we put on this book? And, you know, it was so cool. Like, it was so much fun because we had so many ideas and we were like, you know, why is this artist over here? He should be over here doing this book. Or, you know, I think. like why is the art style doesn't fit?
It's,
or
it's like playing fantasy sports, but you're doing it with comics.
Yes.
You know? Yeah. Like you're making your fantasy team.
Yeah. Fantasy comic book.
Yeah. What creators would be working on what. And I think that's something that it's a rabbit hole. So that kind of thing eventually starts leading you to being a creator, because you start getting in the headspace of what makes these creators tick and why would you want to see them write or draw this character, this story? And eventually that kind of thing where you want to see someone else do that, it becomes you want to start doing that on these kinds of stories. Because I experienced the same kind of thing. Eventually I realized like I didn't want to necessarily write my take on Spider-Man or Wolverine or whoever. I wanted to make characters, new characters, and have them kind of like play with them in the sandbox and have them interact with the pre-existing characters. And eventually the proclivity to want to take over and have these pre-existing characters, that kind of fell to the wayside, and it was just wanting to create all of my own characters. And that's kind of what gave birth to where I'm at now. So it's interesting how all of that will evolve over time.
Yeah, it is, because like thinking back on it, I can see the progression, you know, like and like the evolution of like becoming a fan to becoming a critic to becoming a creator. Like there's almost like this natural progression where you start to deconstruct storytelling, or you know, like take it apart and put it back together and kind of see how things were made, and you know, it like, oh, the artist isn't just like they're not doing it all the time, you know. Maybe it's just he's doing the inks or the pencils or the colors, and then you start to get really picky, and you're like, there's a like the inker didn't ink this guy last issue, like something's off here, you know, like something's different. And you start to like wonder, you know, why is that? And then you start to like hunt, and you start to like see where things have changed and where artists have gone, and where, you know, like the history of not only the creators, and you're like, what was their first book? Like, what did they do? And how did they get here? And, someone did mention Wizard, and that was huge too for me, was Wizard magazine. Like I would find those issues and just be obsessed with the interviews and seeing like what was coming out, and like such a big deal. I remember one of the first Wizard issues I got. It was focused on the Avengers versus JLA book that Kurt Busiek and George Perez did. And, that was just like there was a two-page spread in the magazine of that huge epic battle scene that George Perez drew of the DC heroes fighting the Marvel heroes, and I just remember being like, whoa, like this blew my mind. It was so exciting, and you know, it still to this day, whenever I see George Perez's work, It takes me back to that time where comics were just like this magical place that, you know, felt like an epic battleground that anything could happen.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think the worst thing Wizard ever did was switch their sizing from a comic size to just a standard magazine size. I felt like it lost so much charm with that. And I don't know if it was just coincidence, but it felt like they became more of a pop culture magazine at that point, and it was less and less comic oriented, which was such a, I don't know, it felt like they wanted to compete more with the Entertainment Weekly and all that other sort of stuff, and and they lost sight of what made them so great. I mean, definitely. They had various issues and problems along the way, but I felt like that was a big turning point for me. Just didn't feel the same, because I used to put them in the bags and boards too, because they'd kind of fit like the Silver Age sort of size because they were thicker.
Right.
But then when they went to magazine size, and I would store them in comic boxes, and then when they're in magazine size, I'm like, I gotta buy like a magazine size box. All I really have, really, forget it. And
something my brother and I would do, and I feel like it's not as bad as doing this to comic books. I feel, but it still kind of makes me like cringe a little bit. We would take the Wizard magazines and we would cut out art, you know, from them, and use that for like our own little collages that we would make, or we would like try to. So my brother and I had some ambitious ideas where we would try to make our own trading card games as a little kid, and we would like just cut the art out of the magazine and put it in like little card sleeves and be like, okay, this is a card now, you know, like, this is a character. And you know, we would like it didn't make sense at all, but it was just like, man, we have the materials here, and we can do this now. And so but you know, I don't think I could ever do that because I just feel like it's too sacred now for me. Like, I'm like, oh, I can't, even though it's like a reproduction of the art, I don't know if I could cut it out and do that anymore.
Yeah, I hear what you mean. But you cross a line eventually where it feels sacrilegious to do that. And we had something at Alterna with people cutting out the back of the comic, and people would buy like maybe a dinged and dented issue, something like that, and they would cut it out to get like a redemption, and we eventually had to stop it because almost no one really did it. Maybe we had like 10 or 12 people doing it. And most people were just like, I don't want to cut it. I don't want to. I'm like, well, you know, you buy a second copy and they're like $1 instead. And they're like, yeah, but it's just, it feels wrong to cut in, you know, the page out. And meanwhile, I have all these comics when I was a kid. They're tattered and torn and falling apart. They're written on. They're, you know, things are starred and circled and pieces are cut and whatever. And yeah, when you're a kid, especially, you're just like, whatever.
Yeah, it doesn't. The value, the collector's like mindset isn't necessarily there, and then you start to think about even, money more. Yeah.
Even being precious about them, it just was
right.
Like, you know, it's telling me to do that. What do you mean, don't do that?
Yeah. It's almost like you're getting more out of it in some sense. Like you're actually using it. I remember just recently I was helping one of my LCS owners with this collage idea, this art piece he had in mind, and he had all of these old comics that were the covers had been ripped off and that he had found and people had donated and that kind of thing, and he wanted us to, you know, to cut up the art, and some of these comics were, you know, like old Kurt Swan Superman comics, and they were older, like Alex Toth Green Lantern. I found a short story like Alex Toth Green Lantern.
Wow.
And I was just like, I can't do it. Like, I can't do it. Like, I know this is completely destroyed and no one wants this. Like, the value's gone. But like, I just can't cut up an Alex Toth like picture. Like, this is not gonna happen.
Oh yeah, I mean, that reminds me of when I was a kid in art class in elementary school, and the teacher would want us to do like a decoupage type project or whatever. And
yeah,
you know, I remember seeing like Spider-Man and X-Men and Batman, Superman, all these kinds of old pages of comics in the stacks and the bundles and whatever, and you know, we would cut them up and make our little decoupage with it. And yeah, all I could think is now, looking back, and we all thought it was cool because it was something fun to work with instead of just like grocery store flyers or the newspaper or something.
Yeah.
But I can't imagine. I don't want to imagine what it is we were cutting up and pasting back then.
Oh man, yeah, it's like, oh wow, this was like, yeah, can you imagine like someone did that to their old, like, you know, Action Comics number one back in the day or whatever. It's like, that would be awful.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, heck, you know, they were throwing them away, recycling them left and right, which is what lended a lot of the value to what they currently are.
Definitely.
Which is something I think that I think grading comics came about because they were like, all right, everyone is holding on to these things. We got to find a different way to bolster the condition, a collectability factor on this, because everyone's taking care of their stuff now.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not like the rarity and the scarcity. And because even people kind of crap on a lot of the 90s comics that sold a lot and go, well, they're not really as valuable as whatever. But the biggest reason, it doesn't really have to do so much with the story or anything like that. It has to do with just, they were everywhere at a time period where everyone was taking care of these things.
Yeah.
If no one was taking care of them anymore, and they were just doing what they used to do back in the 50s, 60s, 40s, that kind of a thing with comics, yeah, they'd be extremely valuable to have a mint condition Jim Lee X-Men number one.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, totally. I mean, no one was throwing away those million copies of Spawn, you know, like they kept them all, you know. And to be honest, you know, I don't know if it'll change in the next, you know, decade or two, but I feel like they haven't increased their value by much, but it's still somewhat climbing, you know. It's just very incremental, you know. But yeah. You know, I remember when I would see a lot of those, you know, at much cheaper prices or in the dollar bin or whatever. And now I'm like, oh, these aren't here anymore, you know, like, so that's the thing. Like, you never know. And there are many times where, I will, kind of beat myself up because I could have bought this comic when it was much cheaper than it is now. And you're like, why did I do that? You know, but it happens.
Absolutely. So let's take a turn into the sci-fi part of the conversation.
Sure.
Same question for you in terms of that. With sci-fi, what was your first experience? How'd you get involved with falling in love with sci-fi?
Yeah. So, I mean, this is the most basic answer that I could probably give, but I fell in love with science fiction and space fantasy in particular through Star Wars. I mean, Star Wars was my thing, you know, as it was for, and still is for many people. I remember, you know, my dad having the VHS copies of the original trilogy. And again, I was growing up when the prequels were starting to come out. And so like Star Wars was just this huge, universe that I was getting absorbed into, and you know, I thought, you know, I still think to this day, I think the lightsaber is the greatest weapon ever invented in like science fiction, you know, history, or one of them. You know, it's just so iconic. The name is so cool. You know, they look so cool, different colors. I mean, there's just something really magical about it. And so, you know, with science fiction, it was really the visual aspect of movies like Star Wars, and I became really fascinated with classic science fiction novels like the Foundation trilogy from Isaac Asimov, and some of the more C.S. Lewis has a space trilogy of books that are really fascinating, and I started to really kind of gravitate towards that sci-fi retro like feel and story, you know, storytelling. And so you know, if it wasn't Star Wars in terms of science fiction, the fantasy aspect, you know, really came from novels, but also things like Lord of the Rings and you know, a lot of Tolkien, a lot of that influence was huge, because again, as a child of the early 2000s, you know, the Lord of the Rings movies were coming out, 2001, 2, and 3. And so, like, all of that was just very influential and exciting to me as a kid. And seeing, like absorbing all of that at a young age and kind of processing all of it and seeing, like, these huge worlds and these large ensemble, you know, cast of characters. And the amount of, you know, even with all that spectacle, how much heart there was, how much like emotion there was to these characters and at the core of their journeys and like what they're going through and how they relate to one another. You know, it's just like so timeless. There's like an evergreen quality. I mean, it's a reason why they've been around for so long, but you know, stories like that, they never leave you, and they always stick with you, and you can't escape their potency, you know, and how much they affect you as a creative. And you know, there's definitely science fiction and fantasy aspects in a lot of the superhero comics, you know, that I was reading time. And so, you know, something that, you know, I always loved to like sci-fi horror kind of underlying texture to everything that Lee and Kirby and Ditko were doing. You know, you read like a lot of the older Hulk comics and having that, like, you know, a gamma bomb, like someone like deformed and you know, becoming the Hulk, and it has that like that kind of intermingling of sci-fi and horror. And that was something that really fascinated me as well. And yeah, I also
like
grew
a
up
modern gothic
take, yeah,
you know,
yeah,
being transformed by the world around you and being a victim, and how do you deal with that?
Right. And thankfully my dad, he's 70 years old, and so he grew up in a time where you know, a lot of the black and white sci-fi movies, you know, he grew up with, and you know, a lot of like classics like The Blob from, like, you know, with Steve McQueen, or you had like Them, or The Day of the Earth Stood Still. You know, I grew up watching all of those, and that was something that were just huge for me. And the Twilight Zone, you know, like watching those as a kid, and especially I think for my generation kind of growing up at that time, it was just kind of rare. It's kind of, you know, it's not something that I think, you know, depending on how old your parents were, you know, and how you found those things. I really credit a lot of that love and that passion that I have for the genre because of my dad, because he would show me these, like, just, you know, like things you couldn't find like anywhere else, or and we didn't really grow up with cable. So like he would just have these old classic, you know, Universal monster horror movies that we would watch. And there's something so transportive and you know, creepy and eerie. And it felt like, even though, you know, it was only made 40, 50, 60 years ago, you know, prior, it was like felt otherworldly, you know, and maybe that was the black and white quality to it. You know, maybe that's what made it feel so kind of, you know, different. But yeah, all of that stuff was just huge for me, and it will never leave me. Like I'm utterly fascinated with those genres and falling in love with that at such a young age.
Yeah, that kind of stuff is so foundational, especially towards creating storytelling. I think it's so important that I think they often overlook so much of what came before. Looking at what the current thing is, whatever that they're told to look at, told to be absorbed in, told to concern themselves with. And a lot of the time I talk to people and ask them, you know, they seem like on the surface that they've seen and watched or read or listened to, whatever it may be, everything that's come before already. So that's why they're so hungry for more. And then I'll talk to them, and then there's like so many things that they haven't seen yet. They haven't taken that dive into what came before, you know.
Yeah.
So they're coming from this mindset of the now, and a lot of the times the now, the narrative gets manipulated so that you think a certain way about the product or about the situation at hand, and you never go further. They tell you this is the first of, or this hasn't happened, or this isn't really around anymore. And then if you just buy into it, you think, wow, that I guess that's how it's always been. But if you go and you dive back, you go, wait a second. You just, they're saying this and this, and that's never happened. They never did a story like that, or they never had that kind of character, or they never, but they've been doing this for a long time. Not even like pop culture long, like hundreds of years long, sometimes all of human existence long, like as long as storytelling has been around, which is pretty much as long as there's been communication and culture and civilization. You know, you see the same kinds of themes, the same kinds of things that are kind of communicated in terms of the experience of people. So that's what's so fascinating to me, is that I look around and I'm like, why don't you look back? Look back. Just, and you don't have to go back super far, but it's so important to have that foundation and that sense of perspective.
Yeah, I mean, what really helps me and now, like because I'm really kind of tuned in and obsessed with a lot of my favorite, you know, directors and writers and storytellers, I always, you know, try to find interviews, and I try to listen to like commentaries and things like that. And they will talk about the movies or the stories that have influenced them. And that always leads me, you know, into looking into those things. And I'm, you know, I'm thinking to myself, you know, like George Lucas, you know, for example, it's like, what was he into? You know, like imagine a world before there's Star Wars. Like, I know that's insane. Yeah. Like, but like,
we take these things for granted,
yeah,
that they've always been here, but that's not the case,
right? They really haven't. Like,
who influenced your influences? You know, that's interesting stuff,
yeah. And you know, it's like, okay, well, he was, you know, really into Flash Gordon. It's like, I want to watch those serials now, you know, I want to like absorb myself into like Flash Gordon, what that was like, and a lot of like the old sci-fi stuff that no one ever talks about, or you know, a lot of the Kurosawa films. You know, it's like it's really important, I think, for creators to realize just how much what we do is on the shoulders of what has come before. And that doesn't mean that what you have to offer, you know, isn't unique, or you don't have what makes it you is important. Like, that's really important. But it's like, you can't just pretend like this, we don't have so much to draw from, and that's a resource. That's not like a detriment to your story. That's actually gonna make your story better, because you can dig into those archives and look into all of that stuff and really see, okay, what made this work? Like, what is it in the DNA that makes this affect me in the way it does?
Oh yeah, it's important to have that respect for what came before, while you are fearless about your creativity leading towards the future.
Yeah.
You know, and if you're mindful of what's come before and you have that respect, I really feel like you can confidently be fearless about your own creativity. Mm-hmm. Instead of, you know, looking around and second guessing yourself constantly and wondering, are you following the right trend? Are you doing something that seems like it's the hot now thing to do?
Because
whatever you do, when you start following that, and instead of, because every single thing, that's the funniest thing, right? Every single thing that you love, every single story, character, creative, individual, whatever it may be, if they all just followed what was now and then and cool and whatever it was at the time and didn't pursue their own path, they never would have done any of the things that you love.
Yeah.
And there would never have been any kind of leap forward with anything. So they had to take that chance and go into it and say, well, this is the kind of story I see. This is the vision I have for it. And I'm going to pursue that. And hopefully it resonates with people and you know, it catches on. But if it doesn't, you gotta take your chances. Otherwise, we're not really creating. We're just kind of regurgitating the same thing over and over and over again.
Yeah, we are. We're sort of playing, I don't want to say like telephone, but, you know, we're passing these stories, these mythologies along with every generation. You know, it's like we're handing these stories down to our kids and our grandkids. And it's like, it's this constant, you know, kind of rotation of, I mean, because like, that's not a bad thing. It's like, that doesn't make it unoriginal. It's like there are universal themes and truths that like we're still digging into, you know, what it means to what it means to struggle, what it means to overcome, you know, and the hero's journey, and, you know, looking into like all the Joseph Campbell stuff that you can look into when it comes to that. I mean, all of that is like it's in our bones, you know, in our own mythology and throughout our history. And
I mean, I think it's safe to say we're all still trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
I don't know anyone who has all the answers. You know,
definitely not. And
as soon as we have no conflict, world peace, every problem solved, then I guess people can go, well, I don't know. I guess what stories do we have left to tell? We have it all figured out.
Yeah. I guess we're done. You know, like we got it all. We got it all done.
And
you know,
then we'll start imagining maybe something. Maybe we'll start imagining again about the conflict and the time of and the, you know, because that's all we're doing as storytellers. We're constantly creating problems and solving them in some way, shape or form, or not, maybe prolonging the solution and to whatever interest level it may be. But we're always doing that. We're in this simulated reality that we conjure up day in and day out with storytelling, and we're like, well, what problem do we pose now, and do we solve that problem? Do we let it linger? Do we drag it out and the solution is maybe down the line? You know, you kind of figure out different things, but that's what we're doing over and over again.
You know, I know it was the 25th anniversary of The Matrix a few weeks ago, and I was thinking about that. I was thinking about the importance of that film and how influential that film and that, you know, that property is, and how much it changed the way we look at, you know, AI, you know, and in particular, and like sentience and like technology and all of that stuff. And, you know, it's science fiction movie, you know, even though it's like badass and cool. And like, you know, there's all this, you know, really, you know, neat, like 90s, early 2000s, like aesthetic to it. You know, when you look at it, what it's trying to deal with, what it's like grappling with, they're all science fiction themes and, you know, ideas that are about, you know, sentience and the way technology influences our lives and all of that. And I feel like in some ways, you know, that was not only like a turning point for cinema, but in kind of the way, if you were to look at some of the most influential films and stories over the last, you know, few decades, that would definitely, it still holds up because it's almost even more relevant now than when it came out. And that's always fascinating to me when you find those stories where you're like, well, this was like really ahead of its time, and, you know, was a risk, you know, and we don't necessarily get those risks anymore. You don't really or see them on the scale that they used to be. And that's you know, it's so crazy because, like, you know, this is something that really inspires me as an independent creative. When you look back and you think about, and I'm kind of just specifically honing in on like science fiction and fantasy stories here, but when you look at, you know, Dune's really hot right now. Everyone's talking about Dune and the movies and how great they are. And it's like, you know, that story's been around for a really long time. And I know they've made, you know, other movies prior, but when you look back at the history of that book and what Frank Herbert had to go through to actually get that published, it was originally published by a publisher that did car manuals. Like, they didn't publish fiction. They didn't, no one wanted Dune. No one wanted it. And just like with George Lucas with Star Wars, no one understood what it was. What is this? You know, you have a talking dog in a spaceship. Like this doesn't make any sense. And I think and you have to be careful, you know, in the age of the internet, it's a little bit easier to kind of see and feel what kind of works and what doesn't, but you have to go with your gut and go with okay, this I think this is cool and I want to share this with other people. And no matter how many rejections you get, no matter how many times people tell you no, this is weird or this is stupid, sometimes you just have to drown that out and go, hey, I'm making this. This is for me. I enjoy this. Hopefully other people will. I think a lot of the time it'll work out. You just have to kind of trust yourself a little bit more.
That's what's so great too about that direct pipeline that's happening nowadays. You cut away a lot of the gatekeepers, whether that's a publisher, a distributor, a retailer, whoever it may be, even press outlets. You know, you can just go straight with your message, with your story, whoever may be interested in it. And that has become so powerful for people, because you might get rejection after rejection and you're like, you know, I believe in this. I know it's good. I know that I really enjoy it, and other people I think will enjoy it too. Let me get out there. And before, that was a very daunting task, near impossible. But now it's become a way that I would like to see more and more people use. I'd like to, I scratch my head every day wondering why are people still going through so many traditional outlets for everything, whether it's music, movies, TV, books, you know, just go direct. And especially the bigger question being, if you already have a massive following, you know, like it's very risky when you're on the indie level, just starting off and you don't know what's what, you got a day job or two, you're putting every little last second of the day that you have into this and hoping that over a year or two you'll have what you want. But when you've been in the traditional system and you don't like it anymore, you know that it chews you up and spits you out and you've had your fill of it, I don't understand the people who just continue then to stay in that. You don't need to do that anymore. Get out of it. Go direct.
Yeah, there's a third way. You know, that's kind of how I always look at things. You know, a lot of the time people will say, and for a long time it has been either this or this, but no, now there's a third option. There's a third way to, you know, that maybe you're too scared to commit to, or it's just a little bit, you know, you don't know the terrain. You're just not comfortable in that area. But it has so much more, you know, freedom, so much more opportunities. And at the end of the day, in some ways, you know, it's a lot more pressure, but it also leaves you like looking at yourself and looking at your situation and going, hey, this is on me, you know?
Nobody else to blame at that point.
If I succeed or fail at this, it's on me, and I don't have to blame anyone. I don't have to get bad blood with anyone. It's like, this is my thing. This is what I want to do. And you know, I think that's powerful. That's when you realize that and you understand that this is on your shoulders, and it's, you know, you have to put in the time, you have to put in the work. Once you accept that, it's about acceptance of that. And then from then on, it can become routine. It can become a part of your journey, and it can become a part of what makes you special or stand out, you know, in this industry, because people see it, people realize it, and they go I want whatever he has, you know, what is he smoking? What is happening over there? So that's inspiring to me when I see that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I think there's a part of that aspect of the full responsibility for it, getting out of the traditional system, getting away from a publisher, whatever it may be, not using a studio like a, you know, the movie studio system, or being part of like a record label or whatever that traditional pipeline is, if you're in this kind of a field. I get that it seems frightening, and you know, well, what if something goes wrong? You can't point to someone and say, well, they screwed us, or they did this wrong to us, or whatever it may be.
Yeah,
you gotta own it and then bounce back and learn from that, and hopefully you don't repeat your mistakes. But there's tremendous amount of power with that responsibility. You know, you're not in that situation anymore where you feel like your life isn't yours. You know,
yeah,
you're the one that is responsible for your own success and your own failures. And I think that's a great thing, because it's being like, when we were in the distribution system for about 12 years, there were so many things that were going on that I would try to offer solutions nonstop for different things that were occurring, and shot down at every level. Because, you know, it was out of their control, it was out of my control, it was out of the retailer's control, there was someone involved with something else that you couldn't do that, and that was why. You know, it was all this kind of bureaucracy involved that tied things up. And you would just feel like you had no control over any aspect of anything you were doing. So it felt like, you know, no matter what your effort was, it didn't really matter. And sometimes the outcome would be great, and sometimes it wouldn't be. But you examine your effort and go, I don't understand why sometimes it's working and sometimes it isn't. Because there's a million other factors involved that you have no control over when you're in those systems, that sometimes this thing that's amazing, a great story, great character, you think it's going to work out, and you give it all your effort, and it doesn't do a damn thing. It's just silent, makes no impact. And then there's other things that you're like, yeah, this one's okay, we'll put it out there and, you know, just let it do its thing. Almost no effort given to it, and it takes off.
Yeah.
It's like, so you sit there wondering, like, I don't know what it is, I can't figure this system out.
What did I do? Yeah.
And you're kept at like multiple arm's length. So, you know, like the distributor doesn't want you to interact with the retailers don't want you to interact with the customers, you know, and at the end of the day, you're just kind of creating and operating your business in a vacuum.
Yeah.
And you only know a very superficial element of what is actually occurring, you know, and it's through the game of telephone where they tell you that this is what's happening and that's why. And, you know, if you're doing good, keep it up. And if you're not, you know, do this instead. But you're like, I don't know if any of that matters.
Yeah.
But like this, you could actually cut all of that out and get straight direct access to the people that are interested in what it is that you're doing. And you have all these other avenues that you can, you know, like this show right now, people are getting to know you, you know, and then it'll be out there for forever and people can continue to see that. And it's a wonderful thing. But, you know, 10, 20, 30 years ago, this sort of interaction was a guarded thing. I couldn't just make this show, and, you know, you couldn't just go on this sort of thing, and you couldn't just make your book. You know, you had to have all these approved people giving
all
you
the red tape.
That stamp of approval along the way. And I can't imagine how many amazing things we missed out on because of that.
That is so true. It makes you wonder how many opportunities were lost, and how many retailers may have suffered, you know, like, or creators, you know, vice versa. It's like, who knows, just what we've kind of hindered ourselves from doing. And I think, you know, I think that's definitely, you know, hindsight's 20/20, but like, that's definitely something to consider, and it's something to try to right the ship. You know, I mean, there's nothing more satisfying than a creator, you know, someone who's putting their work out there and getting that direct feedback, you know, rather than like the publisher or the agent or whoever is like, oh yeah, yeah, they like it, or oh yeah, they hate it. It's like, okay, now, like, what are they actually saying? You know, like, what is it that they're saying, and how can I improve or what are they wanting? You know, what are they wanting next? And
yeah,
I think that's really important, not only for your own like process, but to be able to educate yourself, especially on the business side of things. You know, there are so many people who, you know, we're kind of so like, you know, perplexed and confused with how the market is supposed to work, or what is successful, and you know what that means, and how all of that kind of breaks down numbers wise. And it's like, actually the independent route in doing that, it just, you educate yourself and you learn so much about how this is actually supposed to work and what kind of solutions you can come up with. Like you were saying, if like you had these ideas that you were like, hey, like maybe this, or you know, we could try that. And you know, for that not to be available to you, and not like you know, maybe it was considered but just not possible, it's like man,
yeah
like this is not what we need right now. You know, there's it, you know, it's like, you're telling me my books can't like maybe get into the store? It's like, I could drive up there and just put my books in there, you know what I mean? Like you just do it yourself. It's like the DIY version of trying to get access to all of these avenues. So yeah, and you know, the digital market, you know, is a whole other conversation, but like just how much that has kind of changed the way we read comics, the way we you know, absorb entertainment and all of that. I mean, it's just it's really something you have to take time to consider and think about what are our options now, and what can we do to kind of harness this better.
Yeah, absolutely. Adam, thank you so much for becoming a channel member. Appreciate that, man. Enjoy your stay at the Comic Book Lounge. You get access to all those emojis in the chat, and then you also get access to over 100 member exclusive videos, all of which including the open mics that we were talking about earlier on the show.
Oh, very cool.
On there. So yeah. Members get access. It's over 100 something episodes of that open mic show. You get to see a lot of different creators. Maybe you see some familiar faces. Maybe you can spot Nando's first appearance on an open mic show. Go back. You know, but yeah, it's that's the thing that's so great about all of this is that building, you're constantly building something. You know, it never feels like your effort is wasted. It never feels like while you're making your comic, you're doing your thing, you're building your brand, your company, your whatever it may be, your imprint, it feels like everything is adding in a positive way, as opposed to sometimes when you're stuck in that other system, you don't really know sometimes if you're building positively. There's a lot of people over the years who've submitted to Alterna, and I always try to stress that just because maybe I don't think it would work here doesn't mean that it wouldn't work for you or somewhere else, you know. So it depends how much are you willing to put in the work and the effort, and how strongly do you believe in what you're doing. As long as you got those two things, you're set. You know, sky's the limit. You're the only person getting in your way is you. You know, so if you can have that, but if you are going to a publisher or a retailer or whoever, expecting for them to pump your tires and believe in you more than you believe in you, that is a very precarious place to be.
Yeah. You become very dependent. You know, you're like, oh, like everything you do is hanging on them, and that, you know, you're at the behest of them. You know, you're at their mercy. It's like, ooh, like that's not where you necessarily want to be. And I won't name any names in terms of the publishers, but in the last few years, you know, we've seen some really awful things happen to creators when it comes to their publishing deals and things they've had to go through, where it's like, they said my book would come out at this time, but I don't know where it is. You know, I don't know what happened to it, or I don't know if I have the rights anymore to what I own, you know, and what I put with them. And so like things like that really, you know, is such a cautionary tale. And I feel for those people, because I would be so upset and so frustrated to have put in all this work and also to be so excited about being published or being with a publisher, and then having that passion and excitement like stolen from me by the same people that I thought were gonna, you know, get it out there or you know, help put it in stores and whatnot. And so, you know, whenever I see stories like that, I feel for those creators so much, because I know how I would feel in that situation. And it just makes me kind of like, you know, take the sweat off my brow and be like, "Whoa, I'm glad I dodged that bullet," you know? And like, I just like, I'll stay in my own little world here and, you know, keep doing my thing. But I do think there's a lot of opportunities and amazing things that the traditional market has for people. But I think the problem is, it's just not the only way to do things. And I think a lot of people get stuck in that mentality where, oh, you know, it's always been done this way, this is the only way to do it. And you know, I get that proclivity to want to do that, because it kind of gets yourself off the hook from having to put in, you know, all the work and the effort and to like promote yourself and get your stuff out there. But at the same time, yeah, you're putting everything on someone else. And like you said, no one's going to be there for your book like you are going to be there for your book. No one's going to be talking about it the way you're going to be talking about
it. Yeah, let's hope.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's like we hope. We hope and pray, and we'll see. But yeah, it's just, yeah, I think there's a lot to consider, especially when you get into indie comics or the comic book industry and that space, and trying to understand that you are your best supporter and you're your biggest fan, and not in an ego way, not in a like, you know, ooh, I have the greatest thing ever. It's just you believe in what you're doing, and that's really important for people to see.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, I think for a lot of creators, if not for every one of them, but definitely for a lot, the urge even to create something like that on that magnitude and get it out there and tell people it's worth their time, it's worth their money, that usually stems from being dissatisfied with what you already see being put out there.
Right.
And it doesn't mean that you have to hate it or anything like that, but it means that you're hitting a point when you're reading a comic or you're watching a movie or whatever it may be, and you start rewriting it. You start creating. Yeah. Why did that character do this? Why is the story going like this way? Why is the plot playing out like that?
Yeah.
You know, and you start doing these things, and eventually you do them enough that you start coming up with your own ideas and your own characters and your own, and then you put that out there. And it all stems from, you see it and you experience it time and again, that level of dissatisfaction, and you start putting your money where your mouth is. Now, not everybody does that, but I think a lot of the creators that do that, I think a lot of it stems from that, of seeing that kind of thing. And it kind of inspires you to create. Now, it doesn't mean that what you're going to create is any good off the bat.
Yeah, yeah.
But it still is that spark of inspiration for a lot of people, where they're seeing all these things and they're going, well, you know, they created something. Why can't I create something?
Yeah, yeah. I love that feeling. I love seeing that. And I love it when I see people who have been dissatisfied, and rather than just complain, they build, they create. You know, like that is what you should do with all of that, like, frustration and
yeah,
energy.
Put that energy, make it a positive thing.
Exactly, because otherwise it's just gonna ruin your day. You know, it's just gonna ruin your time. And I mean, there are so many things that a lot of people have beloved over, you know, the generations, over the years. And when something happens in that franchise, or there's something that they just, you know, it upsets them, it's like, it eats you up inside. And it's like, okay, either, you know, we need to just love what we love about it and let things be, or maybe you can take some of that frustration and you can go either, you know, I don't necessarily believe in doing like, this is how I would have done it, because sometimes that can get a little, you know, fan fiction-y, but like at the same time, you can, it can be the seed that creates something entirely positive and entirely good for you as a creator and as a fan. And then again, if you feel that frustration, other people most likely feel it too. And they'll get behind that and they'll be like, yeah, like I like what this guy's doing, or I like what this, you know, publisher is doing, because it makes me feel that escapism. It makes me feel that love for that nostalgia, you know, and what we can get out of this story and out of this new property that's all new and fun, you know. And so I really think that that's a great way to turn that energy into something good and not just like self-destruct, you know. Everything sucks, you know. It's like, don't.
And I think if you're one of the, if you're in the minority of people who make the first thing and then go, I think I'll make the second thing. Now, that's a minority of people. A lot of people, they make the first thing, and that's even a minority to actually completely make and get out the first thing. But if you do that, I think a lot of the time people gain perspective and they look back at the thing they were complaining about and they go, wasn't as easy as I thought it would be. And then they kind of, you know, and you do it long enough. Yeah. And you eventually build up more perspective, and then you even build up a sense of respect for some of the things you were dissatisfied with.
Definitely. Exactly. I think that's a really good point, because, you know, you don't realize, people think it's so easy, you know, from outside. They think, why didn't they just do that? Or why, you know, what happened? It's like you really have no idea until you're actually in it. And you're trying to make it, you're trying to make your own thing and realize how much of a struggle it is to get something that feels right, that feels consistent with your story and the kind of story that you're trying to tell. And, you know, you start to, you get that sense of like, like, I'm kind of sympathetic towards people that, are creating this work. And, you know, it's not easy to make a movie. You know, it's not. And everyone goes into it thinking, hopefully, I mean, we hope everyone going into the movie they're making is thinking, this is the best, you know, that I can possibly make it. And like, that's the trust that we're giving the creator. And, you know, I mean, who wants to put all of their time and energy and money into something that they're like, this isn't my cup of tea or whatever.
Well, that's when you eventually start learning too, that, and you can't learn this unless you get in it, that creatively, maybe your idea is better than this idea was creatively executed.
Yeah.
But logistically, given the parameters, given what, you know, maybe they had to work with, who they had to work with, what were they up against at that point in time, you know, who had the say, who was writing the checks. Then you start going, oh, there's like 100 other things I didn't think would go into it. that shaped the creative execution of whatever that was, you know. And whether that's movies or comics or however it may be, like you were talking about before, when you were a kid and you're kind of putting creative teams on different books.
Yeah.
And then you learn certain things of like, oh, I couldn't have put that creator with that one because they hate each other.
Yeah.
Or I couldn't have put that creator at that company because they were fired years ago and they were they're so pissed they don't want to ever go back, or, you know, all these different issues know, or they couldn't have worked at this point in time on this because they were signed to an exclusive on a contract for 10 years over here. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's like later on you learn about all these different things that are like, oh, there's all these moving parts that you're not aware of that affect whatever the end result is. And fortunate, unfortunate, it's kind of like it doesn't really matter, because at the end of the day, it's just, that's the realistic aspect of what this comes down to. But you don't really get the knowledge of that until you get in it. And then you start going like, oh, there's a lot more to this than just come up with a character and a story and then go.
There's so many other things you have to consider. And you know, especially in any medium that you're working in, it's like, if you're not like aware of how that medium works, or like the tools and what you need that creates the effect on you that you're looking for. I mean, you know, you don't know what you're doing. You know, you can't just write a story, especially a comic book story, put it in a comic, you know, and have it be, you know, like 19 pages, because that page turn isn't going to work right. You know what I mean? Like you can't, you have to think about that kind of stuff, and you have to think like, how am I packaging it? Am I going to have a blurb on the back of it? You know, like what kind of promotional material do I have for this? And what kind of budget do I have for it? You know, I want the comic to look like this, but I can't afford that artist. You know, it's like all of those things start to get into play, and you start to realize, oh crap, like this is not how I imagined it to be. And also it can really be discouraging if you're not prepared for those types of things, or if you can't adapt quickly. You know, and I think a lot of people in Hollywood or in the mainstream or whatever, you know, a lot of the time they're just kind of adapting, you know, like to what they have to work with. And they're like, oh, okay, I have to move over here, I have to do this because, you know, I'm feeding my family, you know, who knows like what their reasons may be. And it really, yeah, like that's the balance, right? That's what we're all trying to get. We're trying to balance that creativity and like what makes the story ours. And then also what is like what the people want and like what you're allowed to do, you know, depending on who you're working with. But you know, one of my favorite stories, it's one from one of my favorite film directors, Mark Duplass, the Duplass brothers. They've done a lot of great indie films, and they're particularly they stay indie. They barely work with studios because of this one time that they worked on this movie with the studio, and they called them into the trailer because they were like, we don't like the color of these throw pillows in the scene. You need to change. You need to redo the scene, reshoot the scene, because the throw pillows, they're not working for us. And Mark Duplass had like a nervous breakdown when he had that conversation with the studio, because he was like, what the F does the throw pillows have to do with the story that I'm trying to tell? And like, you know, there's so many stories like that people have when it comes to being constrained in what you can do. And you know, that's the nature of the beast that you have to contend with. But you have to, thankfully, you know, they've been able to find a way, and that's what we have to do as creatives and independent people. It's like we have to find a way to make what works for us without sacrificing who we are and like what we want our story to be. And you know, if you can find that balance, like, man, that's when you're cooking, you know, that's when you've got the goods and you're off to run, you know, and hopefully that's, you can go stratospheric. Yeah,
that's just good advice for life, man.
Yeah, you know,
to try to make your story, your life, what you want it to be without sacrificing who you are.
Yeah, yeah, you are your main character.
Yeah.
Yes, of your story. That's right.
Absolutely. All right. So I want to take a couple minutes here to share your campaign. So we got the Fabled Offering. Now this is a second chance campaign, correct?
That's right.
It was on Kickstarter first.
Yeah. So we raised over $5,000 on Kickstarter last year in the fall, October, November, and Marco Roblin, the artist of the book, he has 3 pages left to color. And then we're going to get it lettered and send it off to the printer. So before we send it off to the printer, I wanted to do one last shot and try to promote this book as much as possible to get people in. And yeah, so here we are. This is the second chance campaign for the Fabled Offering. It's a 44-page sci-fi fantasy one-shot that if people respond to it well, it won't be a one shot, but it does tell a complete story, and it is 44 pages. So you get this epic story about Grand Princess Aurelia, who is on a quest to save herself from her own past trauma. And she is on this journey while pregnant to try to meet the ancient Sizen, who is this ancient deity of this world. And her motivations for doing so remain a mystery. And why she is going through all of this alone, going on this journey alone while being a princess. You know, what is that all about? And so there's this all these questions that I hope readers will, you know, start to ask as they start the story. And if they look at the art and they look at this campaign, and hopefully the gears start turning and they start to realize that, you know, this is a story about sacrifice. It's a story about what you're willing to give up to complete your mission, and who you want to be, and what kind of decisions that you have to make to fulfill your needs as a person, and kind of what life has thrown at you and what life has thrown at Aurelia. So she's royalty, but she is on her own in the story. And so you get to see this warrior princess on a quest to try to make right things that she's been wronged. So yeah, that's our book.
Nice. So you've got sci-fi elements and fantasy elements. What are some of the sci-fi elements?
So the sci-fi elements, the kind of the way I broke down this world, you'll notice that a lot of the science fiction elements have to do with the deities, with these otherworldly beings that, you know, have starships. You know, my pitch to Marco when I gave him my like 20 to 30 page visual document that kind of summarized how the world will look and how the characters look and whatnot was, you know, what if a Star Destroyer showed up in Middle Earth or, you know, whatever. It's like, what, like, how do you make that work without it feeling and looking derivative, but also just wrong? You know, like you can't genre mash like just willy-nilly. Like, it has to make sense and it has to work for the story. And so a lot of the science fiction elements kind of deal with the deities and what they're you know, capable of and what kind of technology they have. And there are also a couple of characters that have technology. So something that it's not a spoiler, but something that's really important to the story is there's this kind of this centerpiece, this convergence point at this mountain called Mount Gephira. And this is where Sizen, the ancient deity of time, comes and meets with the inhabitants of this world. Now, this mountain in particular, people can come to it from all different timelines. So you get to see technology from the future come into play with characters that might be from generations ago. And so there's this, you know, like I said, it's kind of a convergence point where to Sizen, to this deity of time, you know, he's outside it. His domain is outside it. So when he is interacting with characters, it's also why he has three faces that represent the past, present, and future. While he is interacting with these characters, you get to see how the inhabitants in this world has kind of developed, and you get little kind of world building visual elements that kind of cue you in. So that's kind of where we are with the science fiction. Now the fantasy has to do a lot with kind of the garb and kind of the attire of the characters, and also
I can see the visual. It's a little more on the nose with the fantasy.
Yeah. And so you really get a sense of, you know, the like epic kind of Tolkien-esque idea of, you know, where these characters are traversing, you know, kind of mountainous ranges and you know, kingdoms and that kind of thing. It all has kind of those, I guess, fantasy tropes in a sense, but we throw a lot of, like, that ship right there on that page, that is a Sizen's ship. So you see how it kind of sticks out. You know what I mean? It's like, what is this obelisk like, you know, entity, this component to this world, this visual? It's like, it feels otherworldly. It feels alien. So I wanted kind of the world itself to feel ancient, to feel older, to feel rugged and kind of grounded. And then everything else about the interactions with these characters, with that contrast with, you know, the sacred, the heavenly, you know, that kind of thing. It's like, this feels different, and it feels like a clash of worlds, and it feels like a clash of tones. But that's because my thinking was, if there was a world that had these ancient beings, that had these godlike creatures, that, you know, they would not resemble the world we know. And so that's kind of where we are with it, and kind of looking at that mashup. And Aurelia, she has a flaming sword, and it's kind of like a play on that idea of, you know, it's not just a sword, but it's not a lightsaber. It's like a flaming sword, you know, it's a laser sword, it's a flaming sword. And so kind of trying to play with little ideas like that. Sizen also has the staff that has a red, like crystalline dagger on the tip of it. And, you know, it has properties to it, you know, that are more mystical, magical in nature. And so it was kind of my way of looking at the foundational aspects of science fiction and fantasy, the idea of science and magic, and trying to make it make sense within the world itself, where it's not about, you know, class or different races or anything like that. It's about the contrast between what is born of the earth and what is, you know, from on high, from like the heavens, from these deities and these creatures that are not a part of the world. And so that's kind of where you'll start to see that divide. Sorry for the long answer, but that's what I was kind of going for there.
It's funny because with this, what I see, I don't know how well versed you are in like ancient civilizations, ancient cultures, that kind of a thing, but
yeah,
there is that merging of what you could consider to be science fiction, fantasy, and that old world ancient aspect. And I think we look at it too much through the lens of myth and legend and ancient and this and that or whatever. But if you look at it through our current lens, and we see, and I'm not saying to do like a presentism kind of a thing and bestow like a morality upon it. I'm more saying people didn't have certain words for certain things. You know, they didn't have spaceship as a word.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so you would describe certain things in certain ways. And in these texts, if you just look at them and you can see the drawings and you can see the myth and you know, you dive into that, there's a tremendous amount of what you would consider sci-fi alongside the ancient world, which is, you know, is an interesting thing. I'm not going to say that it's aliens, but maybe it was aliens.
Exactly. That is kind of right on the money there. And, you know, something that I really tried to avoid in the story is you won't see the word spaceship. You know, you won't see those like common terms and those common terminologies for things that you would usually see in other properties, because everything about this world, I wanted it to, you know, transport you in a way that, you know, even, you know, like, I hope people who love the things that I love when I talk about, you know, Star Wars and Lord of the Rings, and when I think about some of my favorite fantasy comics like Seven to Eternity, you know, I want people to look at it and hopefully it draws them in. But when they start to read it and they start to like engage with the world, you're not gonna like think of, hopefully you're not going to think of other properties and other franchises that make you go, oh, you know, he's just like kind of playing around with these words to make it sound different. You know, I tried to make it where you're not going to really, it's always kind of, again, it's a balance of like what fantasy can do and what it's, what's possible. It's like, you don't want to, like, there are a lot of made up words and a lot of like terms that I tried to make sense within this story, but not so much that you're not going to understand what they're talking about. You know, that's where you have to kind of be careful, because, you know, unless you read the appendices, you know, for like some of these fantasy books or all the terms and whatnot, you're not going to know exactly what they all mean. And so, especially within, you know, the real estate of what a comic book has to offer and what you can do within it, it was really important that, you know, what you're reading about, you can understand, but there's still a lot of that kind of wordplay and that like sense of, that sounds cool. Like, what is that? You know, what, like, how does that roll off the tongue when you say it, and how are you reading it in your mind, you know, and how would they kind of perceive it, you know, what would the reader think? So playing with that was really fun. And I mean, it was the most world building that I've ever done with any of my stories, with any of my comics. And like I said, I put together like a 20-30 page visual document that I worked with Marco, the artist for the book, on. And, you know, we really strive to make sure that, you know, while we were drawing from things we love and influences that inspire us, it really has the potential to come into its own and be a whole separate thing.
So I know you say that it's a one shot, but is that set in stone?
Yeah. So I really am leaving it up to the readers. I really want to see what people think, and I really hope that they want more. There is more story to tell, but in terms of Aurelia's journey and what she is going through and her arc in this particular story, you get the beginning, middle, and end of it. So you definitely get the full idea and kind of the theme of the book and the heart of the story and what this kind of is about with her. But if people really enjoy this world and they want more of it and they want to see what could happen next, I would love to. Marco is bugging me like day and night. He's like, dude, we need to like do more, we need to like expand this more because it's too good not to. And I'm like, I want to, I really want to, like, I think like I would do it in a heartbeat. But I guess I'm just super focused on getting this particular book out there and seeing what people think. And then if I notice that people are kind of chomping at the bit and they're messaging me and they want more, then I will definitely go that route for sure.
Oh, very nice. Awesome. Well, Nandor, thank you so much for being on here today, man. Thank you for the conversation. This was great. Really appreciate it.
Oh, yeah, dude. Anytime. I had a blast talking with you. And I think conversations like these in the indie community and just in the comic book community in general are priceless. And they're really important for people to engage in. So I thank you for this platform and thanks for having me on.
I absolutely agree. And yeah, man, thank you for being here, being on. Appreciate it. And everybody in the chat, thank you guys too for being here as well. Thank you for your questions, your comments, all that good stuff. Always appreciated. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to give it a thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to the channel, ring the bell, all that good stuff. Nandor, where can they find you?
Yeah, so please subscribe to my newsletter. It's foxholecomics.substack.com. So that would be amazing. You can also find me on YouTube, Foxhole Comics. That's my imprint. That's what I have all my books under. And so I don't update my YouTube channel very regularly, but I do update it and do live streams and talk about what I'm working on and things like that. So if you want to kind of get in on the ground floor of my new projects and what I'm working on, please subscribe over there on YouTube. And then also I'm on Instagram at Nandor Fox Schaefer and X Twitter at Nandor Fox, and you can find me there.
All right, perfect. Everybody, thank you guys again. Nandor, thank you, man. This was great. Really appreciate you spending some time with me tonight. And thank you for being generous with your time as well. And all the best to you with everything that you're working on, man. The Fabled Offering is on Indiegogo. If you guys missed it the first time around when it was on Kickstarter, go check it out. The link is in the description of the show. And yeah, thank you, man, for being here. Appreciate it. And everyone, have a wonderful evening. I'm going to be back tomorrow night. It's going to be an open lines show. So you guys determine the topic. Whatever's on your mind, let me hear it. Let's talk about it. And I'll be back again tomorrow night. I'm going to be doing 9:30 Eastern tomorrow night. So I'll be back a little bit earlier than what I was on tonight at 10. But I'll be back at 9:30 Eastern tomorrow. Open lines show. See you guys then. Until then, everybody, have a great night and an even better tomorrow. I'll see you guys soon. All the best.